Okay, here we are. I am very happy today because we have Professor Hans Litschek among us. He's a very nice person and a very prominent quantum chemistry. And I think he has a big part of his heart here in Brazil. So I'm really happy to have you here, Hans. Thank you very much. I'm just going to present you. I have just a brief presentation about your successful career. Let's see if I can do it in short. Professor Hans Litschek started studying chemistry in Vienna in this period, 1961 until 1969. And his supervisor was Professor Gerhard Derfringer. I'm sorry, I cannot tell the name in the right way. But there is a special thing about this professor. He was the first one in 1961 who did the first quantum chemical calculation on the computer in Austria. This is a very, very interesting information. And another interesting information about Hans Litschek's career was that in 1967 and 69, together with his supervisor and one of his friends, they organized and programmed the first computer enrollment at the University of Vienna. I mean, they were quite advanced in that time. And then he moved to Germany to go for a postdoc period with Professor Kurt Zelnig, who was a very important person in quantum chemistry with great contributions with relativistic quantum chemistry, coupled cluster methods, and many other methods that we still use and I'm sure we are going to use for a long time. In 1976, he got the habilitation. That is a kind of livre docência for us in Brazil. And then he started to walk around the world. The first visit was to United States with Professor Chavit. And then he returned to Vienna. And after that, a lot of visits again to the United States. And more recently, he was professor in China. And now he returned to Texas University, where he is, Texas Tech University, where he has been working since 2019. Just a few contributions. During his postdoc in Karush, he worked on coupled electron pair natural orbitals program. I mean, it was very necessary. I mean, it was mandatory to do a kind of approximate calculations because in that time there was no very high computers available. So it was a very important contribution at that time. And during his visits to Ohio State University, he started the development of what we now call Columbus program. I think that most of us have been using this program for running our calculations. And an interesting fact about the Columbus was the first code to be distributed with anonymous FTP. I think that the younger students don't know much about anonymous FTP, how it was in that time, but it was a very step forward for distributing codes. And in the 80s, he implemented analytical gradients at multi-reference CI code that is in Columbus and generalized these gradients for analytical gradients for other methods like ACPF, AQCC, and others. Again, during the 80s, he was one of the first to start parallelization of codes. And together with other guys, they wrote the parallel version of MRCI code in Columbus. He also implemented analytical computations of Noah Diabatic coupling vectors, and this opened a huge area of work that we call nowadays computational photochemistry. So another very important contribution. And in 2005, together again with other students and collaborators, they started the development of Newton X for quantum non-adiabatic dynamics calculations. Among his several scientific interests, I just highlighted the development of Columbus, of course, with focus on multi-reference theories, graphene defects, organic photovoltaics, computational photodynamics, excited states of these species that is going to be the topic of this seminar, and other subjects. A few awards. In 72, he received the Alexander von Humboldt Fellowship. In 1980, Sandoz Prize of Chemistry. In 1990, Max Cady Fellowship. In 2008, he was he was a homage for him in chemical physics with the Fritz Schrift. And in 2008, there was a seminar named Electron Correlation and Molecular Dynamics for Excited States, a tribute to his contribution to our field. And he's, as I said, he's also engaged in developing software. Maybe the most famous one is Columbus, also NewtoX, and more recently OpenMoCast 2. Just a brief summary of about his career in numbers. He has around almost 400 papers, index age 67, and more than 10,000 citations. So it's a very successful career, and I'm really glad to have you among us today. And I should thank you for everything you have done for the development of computational quantum chemistry. And during this seminar, I don't ask Hans before, but I'm going to ask you, if you wish, you can ask at the end. And please keep your microphone mute. If you want to ask something during the presentation, I don't know if Hans agrees with that or not, but what do you think, Hans? Can they ask during the presentation?
If there's something really unclear, people can ask me during the presentation also.
Okay, so I'm going to take care of this. And if you want to ask during the presentation, just raise your hand, okay? And I'm sure everybody will enjoy your seminar. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Hans. I'm just going to close my presentation and you can start yours. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you very much, Antonio, for your kind introduction. You brought times long ago into my mind again. I think it's better to talk about this in the evening with a caipirinha in the hand. Was very good to hear all this, and it's really a great pleasure and a joy and an honor to be here and to give a presentation of my kind of recent work and interest. So I'm going now to try again to share the screen.
Okay.
So this should be the correct one. Yeah. Okay. So let me start. My talk is about excited states and connected to non-adiabatic photodynamics, and then I will talk a bit about this polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons and closely related systems. When Antonio gave his introduction, he talked about old times. I did not know about this, but here's also a figure of these old times. I'm using it only to show these energy surfaces, this is ethylene dimerization. So specific example actually doesn't matter. What I wanted to show is that there are intersections between these surfaces. So there are different electronic states. You have one intersection here. You have two equivalent ones here. And these features determine actually the photodynamics of a system. This is very well known now, but longer time ago, one thought that these conical intersections were the exceptions, but now it's rather the rule. So they usually will dominate the dynamics, and it's important to know where these intersections are located. Here is a figure explaining just very simple way why it is a conical intersection. We have an expansion of the energy around the intersection. One has to use two conditions, so there are two vectors describing this intersection, and here is the explicit formulation. So there's the gradient of the energy differences and the non-adiabatic coupling. If you look at this picture, it looks like this is one point, but we should not forget we used two conditions for the conical intersection. But so that means there are still n minus two dimensions in the conformation space left over, and these form the intersection space. So this is a hyperspace. So the whole thing is a quite a complicated feature, and it is not so trivial to get a good overview about it. One way is to look at the minimum of this in the intersection space. So this is the minimum on the crossing scheme. So I call it here as MXS. This was, as Antonio said, implemented into Columbus. And once in the workshop, I wanted to show to the students the different computational steps, observing it while the Columbus program was running. So I started the program, and then I wanted just to look into the node and show the steps, what is going on. And when I did this, the program already finished. So I realized that these calculations were actually faster than I had thought. And so we were thinking about it, how to go beyond this static analysis, what I was talking here. And the actual next step would be to do some surface hopping dynamics, to do some explicit dynamics. Yeah, here you just have the references of this papers. But then the idea, as I said, came to do a real on-the-fly surface hopping dynamics. We started this, and I was really lucky because there were excellent people around me. You know, there was Mario in that time as postdoc. Then there was Giovanni Granucci and Maurizio Persico. They had written actually a surface hopping program for semi-empirical methods. So we joined, and we could use a part of their code, and they were helping a lot. And then all the people here are very important. And so this is also an original slide from the time of around 2009. Where we had described the first way how to do this Newton X program. You see Thales surface hopping, different methods. So we started with Columbus, but it was clear that even though this was relatively fast, that we could not really stay only with Columbus. So you have here Turmol and DFDB, and we also started QMM dynamics at that time. this goes on like this. And here came another important point by the contribution of Jerzy Bittner to calculate the non-adiabatic coupling from the overlap of the electronic wave functions of two adjacent time steps. This was very important because this gave the possibility to calculate non-adiabatic effects for methods which only gave the gradients for excited states, and then one can calculate the non-adiabatic coupling in this way, and this opened up many more programs. And here you see a modern version of Newton-X. It is now managed by Mario in Marseille. He does an excellent job, and I need not say much about it. It's opened up to many programs. He's working actively, so this Newton-X is really in excellent hands there. So I want to introduce another of these interests. These are carbon nanostructures, polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, PAHs in short. And here you see a number of well-known structures. What is of interest here are these carbon dots. These are confined PAHs. It is not an infinite sheet like the graphene sheet. Confinement makes a lot of difference, and it gives the conventional spectra and the properties of molecular systems. And then basically, we can look at it as a larger PAH system. Then you have here something is called a carbon nanodots. It's the difference to the above system. Here it is just a single sheet, and here you have stacked sheets, and you have to embed them into some amorphic system. And then we have some more polymer dots with these attached groups here coming mostly from the experimental production. So what we have PAHs, single sheet and stacking. This is the motive what affects describes these carbon dots. And then we started calculations. It's well known that the calculation of excited states of the systems is not so trivial. So we started some systematic investigation. Here you have starting point, the pyrene, and cases where we just move benzene rings around. So like this here in coronene also, this is called here circumcoronene. Circum one coronene with two sheets, circum two coronenes. And this work was done actually during our time in China. So the student who did this was Bai Mei Xi. She did an excellent job. And here you see the list of methods we are using. DDDFT, ADC2, single reference methods, multi reference methods, DFT, MRCI, then this NVPT2 and this SORCI. What you will not see here is, unfortunately, is Columbus. These calculations here would be too large for it, at least in this present version. We do have very good plans to enhance the Columbus, the full MRCI, also by orders of magnitude, but this is still hopefully coming. And so this is what you have currently in terms of methods where one could apply this, these calculations. And let me just discuss here this the pyrene spectrum. So we did, or Pyme did, a lot of calculations. You can see this comparison here. What is really interesting are these two states. This is the LA and the LB state. The LA state is the bright state, and the dark state, the LB state, is below. This is important to note. And so just let's focus on these two lines, and maybe disregard, you see there's a lot of dark states coming here, and more bright states are embedded. But for the fluorescence, which is one of the interesting points, these two states are most important. So you see here this DFD MRCI results. They give a very good agreement. This SO RCI is a bit shifted. NVPT2 also. ADC2 actually also compares quite well with the experimental data. And in the density function domain, you see something different. The bright state, the LA state, comes first, is the lower state. And the dark state, the LB, is higher in energy. Now, and this is not only for B3LIP. Here with CAM B3LIP, they are almost identical. But this problem is persistent to most of the functionals, actually all the functionals I know and we have tried. And you might say, this is not so important. This is just a small in inversion. But if you look at the fluorescence, one follows Kasha's rule. So the system goes to the S1 state, and then it will fluoresce from there. And actually, this is a dark state, so the fluorescence will be quenched, will not be strong. Whereas when you do this with B3LIP, you will predict a strong fluorescence. So, and this is not good. And this makes a problem with many of these density functionals. Now here you have the results of experimental data of PEHs and measurement of a spectra. There are three bands. There's an alpha and a P band. They are weak, and then there's a beta band. And we will compare to these experiments in a moment. Here you have now some extrapolation of the excitation energies here, the S1 state and the S2 states, over all systems together. So there's pyrene, coronin, circumpyrene, circumcoronin, there's everything together with different methods. Our reference method would be this DFD MRCI. We could not do it all the way through, and so the here you see also, so we did also our this CAM B3LIP and also ADC2. So our philosophy is either the best comparison, the best references we're using would be DFD MRCI. If we cannot do this, then we would trust most the ADC2 calculation. Here you see the S1 state kind of in the way of extrapolation, and here the S2 state. And here you see this bend, but this comes that is actually different electronic states. So here we actually one cannot connect this really smoothly. And so here we did really these are extrapolated values according to some this exponential scheme. Here are the experimental data I just mentioned above. And let's look at the difference to the experiments. I mean, it's a bit arbitrary because we are not doing exactly the same. But our systems are also relatively large, so in some way it makes some sense. So B3LIP, you see, does not do so well. This ADC2 is quite okay. Interestingly, this CAMP B3LIP does very well all the way through here. Even though I had some severe complaints at the beginning, this NEVPT2 doesn't do so well. So you can see here, I still, and this goes on for the other states for this P band and for the beta band. It's very similar. So I still would prefer the ADC2 method. It's also not such a cheap method. It's also an ab initio method, and in some cases, but it has to be well selected. Of course, when we can use a DFT also. So I think we have to be pragmatic. So here is only a little bit about the pyrene dimer. This would be interesting to simulate with dynamics. Here we at the moment we only did static calculations. Here is DFT MRCI. Compared here is an experimental value, the bright state here. So here it is the third state you can see here. If I compare this with ADC2, there's a slight difference. The energy is also a bit higher, and this can't be B3LIP. The state is lower. This alone is not. I wouldn't consider such a problem, but it always in all states has a significant charge transfer, which does not appear here in this ADC2 calculation. So this is a bit of a warning sign. Now here we are really doing dynamics of a stacked PEH, but is this the smallest one? Is the benzene dimer. This has been done in the group of Thiago at UEFA Jota. So we have actually three minima. There's this parallel displaced, there's a T-shaped. The T-shaped is the most stable one, but only by a small margin compared to this parallel displaced. And then we have also this the stacked system, the sandwich system. So because we are interested in this stacking, so we started actually from a stacked structure, and we did not really consider the T-shaped structure. And here you see a potential curve of the approach of the two benzene rings. There's always here once these two states here, they split as a minimum here in for the next pair also. And the other state here is repulsive. And if you compare this with a charge transfer, in all the cases where there's a minimum, this is the same color code is this charge transfer. It shows a significant charge transfer. So the XMR formation seems to be or is quite strongly related to also to charge transfer contributions. No, so not only dispersion and other pi stacking, but also charge transfer. Here you have some results from our surface hopping dynamics. So we did it here with Newton X and ADC2. Here you see the average of the distance between the center of mass distances between the two benzenes. So we're starting with a vertical excitation. This gives a lot of surplus energy. So the system is not stable. It finally, because it has too much energy, it dissociates again. But you see a range here of a minimum where some XML formation can occur. And here you just see this was a front page of PCCP where the dynamics is shown. So the charge transfer is related to the distance of the two benzene rings. You can see here. So the blue is the charge transfer. And this orange is the center of mass distance, and you can see always when this center of mass distance goes below a threshold, which was a bit arbitrary, set as 3 angstrom, the charge transfer also increases here and here. And here we have a statistics of this event duration, how long it stays into this gray block, and so this about 200 to 300 femtoseconds. This is the dominant time, and this we can take approximately as the time as some kind of lifetime of this XMR. Then we did a lot of other analysis. We were just looking where the excitation really is. We can do this also from the analysis of the wave function. This has been done by Theodore. This is a program package which Felix Plasser developed. The system, there's a position number. If this is in this range from 1 to 1.33, we say it is on A. If it is on B, then it's other side, and delocalized if it's in between. And you see, so we start by definition from the excitation on A. And in the course of the time, the excitation just disequilibrates, and the excitation is on both systems with equal probability. But you see, there's also some kind of delocalization always occurring in these dynamics. And here, this is really an analysis of the dynamics. I don't have time really to look at this. Maybe we can look at this is the energy gap. You can see this oscillates always between 0 and 1 eV. But here's a region where this oscillation is a bit strongly damped. And this is a situation where the interaction is stronger because there's no gap of 0. So this will also be the time of the Eximer formation, and if you can compare this with here, here you see the distance, yeah, is below our 3 angstrom limit, and also the charge transfer appears here. Here, another system, I mentioned charge transfer. Here is a system, this is TCNE, tetracyanoethylene, with anthracene in a stacked form. This is one of the paradigmatic charge transfer systems. We had studied this long time before, which with much larger basis sets and more. Here I'm showing you only the results with some a bit smaller basis set, because we are also going to do surface hopping dynamics. The states in gas phase, the two lower states are charge transfer states, then come to localized excited states in anthracene, and then here's another charge transfer state. In water, with a Cosmo, you see there are 3 charge transfer states, the lowest, that then come the local excited states. And here, just for comparison, this is for experiment for dichloromethane, the charge transfer bands. The first one agrees, I think, pretty well. The second one is in between these, so our results are a bit higher than this experimental one. Okay, so here you have this surface hopping dynamics. It is not in Cosmo, it is a QMMM a simulation. So with explicit waters at molecular mechanics level, we make a cluster, a spherical cluster of 1,000 water molecules. Initial conditions are, as usual, in a harmonic oscillator Wigner distribution. You see with the thermostat. And we start in the S4 state. This is a local state. We want to study the development of the local pi star state into the charge transfer state. And here you see one also basic problem of single reference methods. We cannot describe well the intersection with the ground state. Yeah, this is for DDDFD very bad, but it is also not better for the ADC2 method. And so what we are doing is we monitor the energy gap with the ground state, and as soon as this gets at 0.1 EV or lower, then we simply stop the simulation and assume that the system is in the ground state. Here you have the spectrum calculated from the energy points of the initial conditions. I think it's always good to do that, to see how the initial conditions really are distributed. Red is water, black is gas phase. So you see this shift here, down here you see the vertical lines. These are the single point calculations at the minimum. So if we look at the dynamics, so we start here, you see the total of 5 states. We start from S4, so this is this violet state. We start here, but there's a rapid decrease in the population of the state. So the system switches to the next, to the green one, which also decays fast. We have here as important states the S2 state and the S1 state, these are to charge transfer states, and the conversion to the ground state is also here visible. It's slow, but it is definite. So finally, we certainly would end up in the ground state. How much this I will show you in the next slide from our fittings. Here in water is similar. The major difference is that the hopping to the ground state occurs much faster. You can see the black curve. So we are at the end of the simulation after 1 picosecond. We have almost everything already in the ground state. We wanted to also to understand to explain a little bit or show how the dynamics of the charge transfer state is. And what is shown here is the character, the charge transfer character of the active state. In surface hopping, we always calculated, of course, this in total five states, including a zero. But in the dynamics, there's only one state where the system is really occupied. It is we call the active state. And the charge transfer character of this active state is here monitored. So at the beginning, so this starts again in S4 with very low charge transfer values. Then you see some oscillations at the end. Then for this one trajectory, it is all charge transfer in the S1 state. So the S1 state and the S2 state actually are charge transfer states. And in the S1 state here, this is so dominating. We looked at the charge transfer states as an entity in total, and followed it only the decaying global. So what we really did is we looked at the evolution of the ground state, the increase of the ground state, and the difference to it is here. This which I said, this is the dynamics of the charge transfer states, having this picture here in mind. And then this is now fitted. And one is the number of, is the occupation that and one is the fraction that does not decay to the ground state. Yeah, here N1, and here's what the rest. And the TE, if I'm not sure whether you can read it, is the decay constant. And then there's also a latency time when this decay to the ground state really occurs. So maybe there are two numbers of interest. This N1, how much will not decay in the gas phase? This fitting shows about 60%, and in water, it's smaller, 8%, or this is really not significant. So one can see that in water, more or less everything will decay to the ground state, whereas in the gas phase, some part should remain in the S1 state. And here you have the decay times. Is 2 picoseconds in water is 0.45 picoseconds, so it's much faster. Then we wanted to know a bit what are the important coordinates for this hopping to the ground state. We have no non-adiabatic coupling vectors, so we cannot just make a straightforward analysis what I showed you before. So we were looking at two critical coordinates. The one is the CC distance in the TCNE. The TCNE will get one charge in the charge transfer process. So the CC bond distance will increase, and you can see this here in the black curve. This is always here, this is gas phase, and this is water. And here you see the center of mass distances, also here in gas phase, and in water, this also increases. And here we have an histogram of these two parameters at hopping time. I think so this is indicates, one can see when the system hops to the ground state, what are these geometries, and the black lines are the black vertical lines are the averages here of the CC distance, sorry, here of the center of mass distance in gas phase. So this hopping seems to be connected to an increase in the center of mass distance. In water, maybe it's even a bit more pronounced, and also of the CC distance. Motivated by this importance of the center of mass distance, here you have now potential curves for the ground state and for the S1 state in relation to the center of mass distance, so the kind of the dissociation of the systems, and here the curves, like the S1 curve, is here quite separated from the ground state. The red one is the charge transfer state, as you can see, and as you would expect. In water, however, this is different. The charge transfer state is stabilized, strongly stabilized, and actually these two curves cross here. So actually, we have two ground state minima. Yeah, here the closed shell, the black one is the closed shell curve, and the red one is the ion pair curve, and there are two minima. And if you look here at the scheme, we have here the photo excitation. Then we have the decay of the ground states, of the charge transfer states. Yeah, these numbers come from the fitting of the last figure, and here we are in the S1 state, here the system can go either way. Yeah, either we can populate a neutral state, and we can populate an ion pair state. And I think this is interesting that by this photodynamics, we are able to have really two quite different states populated. And actually, this has been found also experimentally in some solid state systems, this parachloranil with tetramethyl paraphenylene diamine. They also find something. So I think this is something what one could follow more. I find it quite interesting that these two versions, two structures exist. They would not probably be accessible just at the ground state, but on the way via the photo excitation and on this, and then the way down, we have enough energy to populate both situations. Antonio, how much time do I have?
Okay, it's up to you. I mean,
yeah, up to me. Yes.
I'm not counting the time.
I did not check when I really started.
No, yeah. No, I'm not counting the time.
Adelia, she's the boss. She said 15 minutes.
Okay.
50. Okay. Now, I think I want to hurry up a bit. This is another system what we are just investigating. Let me start. It talks about the restriction of intramolecular motion to get fluorescence. So I want to concentrate a bit more on the principle, because I think it's interesting. Here you see also an old scheme of all more or less possible photodynamical processes. We start here from the excitation, and then the system can relax. Just let me look at this, at the two processes which I want to set into contrast now. This one is the switching, the non-adiabatic switching between two states, and here's the fluorescence. Yeah, this switching between states, as you is ultra fast. It can be in times of femtoseconds up to picoseconds, and so as soon as it gets there. Yes, the fluorescence is much slower, is in the order of nanoseconds. So here I took this situation and this situation again, now just plotting it here. Here you have this conical intersection, and this, and here the decay here to the ground state. Let's assume this is the ground state, this is the first excited state. And there's this fast radiationless deactivation. And this, what happens here is what we call photostability. This happens, for example, in all the DNA nucleobases. We have a photo excitation, so we pump in energy, could be solar energy, for example. And then the system decays very quickly to the ground state with few structural changes. So what actually has happened is that the photo energy is converted to heat. Yeah, the molecule will be hotter, but it will be as it is before. And this is photostability, and then obvious and important property of the DNA bases, because they had to survive the times when the ozone shield was not strong or not existent in the history of Earth, and when these compounds evolved. And interestingly, all these nuclear bases have this property of photostability. So this is also something what we investigated a lot before, but I don't want to talk here about it. What happens to the fluorescence? The fluorescence is quenched because there's no time for fluorescence. The system goes directly to in a radiationless process to the ground state. What is if we can move this red curve, or the red and the black curve relative to each other, to a system as we have it here when there's no crossing? Then we have the fluorescence. And what the so in on the left side we are favoring the photostability because thinking about our DNA, so this is also we're always looking for fast non-adiabatic processes. But on the other hand, the fluorescence is important. It is important for sensors, for these OLEDs, for LEDs, and so on the other hand, we want also to be able to modify some compound to do the fluorescence. Yeah, and this is done among others by by this restriction of intramolecular motions, this is called RIM. And if one looks into more detail about it, maybe I can just show it to you. Actually, it is, one can understand it as a restricted access to conical intersection. So we want to avoid this here. We want to modify to move the system away from here. And the proper characterization actually is, one could say, is RACI. Yeah, restricted access to conical intersections. And here's the importance of this fluorescence. I said it here. One way to do this is the aggregation. Usually the aggregation quenches the fluorescence because of it is H aggregates. We saw it for the pyrene dimer, that the lowest state is a dark state. However, this aggregation can also have the opposite effect by doing this RIM and RACI. And one paradigmatic compound are these tetraphenylethylenes. Tetraphenylethylene in isolated system, in solution or in gas phase, you see the ethylene will make this torsion when excited, will go from a parallel system that the two CH2 groups then look like this. Yeah, you see, and this happens also in this tetraphenylethylene, like this here. But there are also other deactivation processes. So this is a way to a conical intersection. The other one, photocyclization, it is planarization of the phenylene, is also one way. However, when you have it in solid state, this is highly emissive, this system, and this only shows that this torsion is restricted in the solid state. So with this aggregation, one can reach this goal of the fluorescence. But what thought that we could modify this system and achieve this RACI effect, so the avoidance of the conical intersection, not by some stacking in the solid state, but just by substituting it, and this way also to make it the molecule more rigid, so that it can not do this process here and cannot get to the conical intersection. And you see here the names, it's almost done. And so this is a work in collaboration with Dana Nachtigallova, who is also involved in many of these other works here. So we did a number of substitutions. We have here cyano groups. You can read it here. And then we thought a hydrogen bonding might be a good idea. This will also make the system more rigid. Actually, in fact, it does it, but especially in the ground state. Here you see the molecules. For example, here you see the CN groups, and here you see we have CHO, OH, and here we have carboxyl groups, you can see it, and so on. I don't want to go in too many details. So we did here DFT dynamics, but also this DFTB2 here with long range corrected method. And we did surface hopping dynamics. And here you just can see the final results. Here we call this group one, you see, with these nitrile groups. Percent in S1 state. So here we want that it stays in the S1 state. So here it does not. So this we know it from TPE in as isolated molecule will not fluoresce. If I just put one CN group, also not. Here the CN5 looks good, but it doesn't look so good. This truly looks good. So these are here five CN groups on one pair of the benzene rings and this CF3 group. This also doesn't, it looks promising. Here for comparison, this DFTP2, it's also, we did several other systems also in comparison always with DFTP2, because this is orders of magnitude faster. So it's good to know if one has another method, which is semi-empirical, but where we can think that we can expect good results. So if you have these occupations here, so this agrees. Here, this does not agree. It looks like this. But if one looks at the evolution, here this is 1 picosecond. This is here longer, 2 or 5 picoseconds runs. One would, if you look at the energy gap for this here, one can see it also decreases. So it will also go into this direction. So this here also will not survive. But here, this will survive here. This is a good confirmation for one of the systems. With these hydrogen bonded systems, there are only a few cases will really survive. Here comes another process. This is the excited state proton transfer, and this also leads to a conical intersection, and it happens frequently. But there are systems when it's heavily substituted that the compounds also stay in the excited state, so they are also fluorescence candidates. So there, at least there's some way that one we could show that substitution can help, but it has to be on really selected and well prepared systems. Now I have to be even much faster. Singlet fission, I think this the next talk by Josef Michel will be about it. He's, so to say, one of the fathers of this. A singlet state is split into two triplet states, and this makes the efficiency of the photo of the electron formation much higher. And the crucial intermediate state is this. It's called TT state. It is a singlet coupled triplet state, or correlated triplet pairs is another name. Here you find some conditions when this about materials, how to select them. This is certainly a talk by Josef, and you will hear more about it. I want to stress another thing. This TT state has such configurations, and in short, it's a double excited state. So this means that most or all of the good methods we have will not give this state. Yeah. So to deal with this singlet fission is a big problem in terms of computational methods available. And here, this is another recent work from the together with a group of Thiago. Here is the spectrum. Yeah, you have blue are the bright excited states. Dark are the dark broken lines are the dark single excited state. What is important here, this red solid is the this doubly excited state, this TT state. here you see it, and it simply is not available in the other methods. Yeah, and so one really has to use a multi-reference method. Here, I think we will also be able to use Columbus. We have big plans, as I said, to enhance the efficiency of the program really dramatically, and then we could do, and then we would have gradients also, because unfortunately with DFT MRCI one doesn't have gradients. One more topic is also about singlet fission, the tetrazine dimer, but here is orthogonal. Here also from the group of in collaboration with Thiago. Here, this is the solvent effect. This charge transfer state is stabilized in respect to the exotonic states and this TG state. What one can see here. Another work is with the group of Itamar. So it's all here is, with people in Rio. The fluorescence, question of fluorescence of pyrene, I mentioned it. The S1 state is the dark state and the S2 state is a bright state. And how this looks like, so we did ADC2 dynamics. The analysis, the calculations are finished, the analysis is not finished. So it is for an isolated molecule. Here you see it oscillates between S1 and S2. So the Kasha's rule will not be fulfilled, has also been shown by experimentally. The system can fluoresce from S2 or even from S4. And here, collaboration with Francisco on defect states in graphene. So here, single vacancy defect in pyrene. It's interesting, this is of interest in space vehicles, this thermal protective shield is made of carbon systems, and there this heats up a lot when this vehicle gets back into the atmosphere, and then a lot of reaction dynamics where will happen, and here we have an analysis of the electronic states is only part of it. So there are many low-lying electronic states, and this you also only can really simulate with a multi-reference CI. And here we are back at Columbus. We have with Francisco there several other projects have been done and are being done also based on Columbus. Here, acknowledgement, you see the list from Texas Tech. Our time in Tianjin was very productive. Here is Dana, then the Brazilian groups, this Thiago, Francisco, and with Itamar, and I would hope very much also to put a collaboration with Antonio or other people in here. We are open to many collaborations. There is certainly many interesting things available, and you know my obvious connection and admiration of Brazil. It's because of one person, but it's also the country. Then Mario, Felix, and Irene Burkhardt, she's doing quantum dynamics. And so we are using our static calculations for the parameterization of this of the MCTDH calculations of Irene. This is also a very fruitful collaboration. And with this, I will stop. I'm afraid I talked too much, but so this is it. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Hans. Very, very nice talk. It's impressive, the amount and the quality of your work. Congratulations. Congratulations.
Okay.
And you can ask now, please. Questions? Well, I'm going to start. When you said about the restriction of the access to the conical intersection, did you see that what I see normally in this situation is that I stabilize the excited state and destabilize the conical intersection? Is that what you see?
Yeah, in a way, yes. It is the conical intersection is destabilized because as soon as you make this rotation, there's this big bulky group, and this conical intersection cannot be accessed because it becomes too high in energy.
Yes.
Yeah. So we thought either to look at electronic effects, therefore we did also these CN groups, but it seems to be more like really the question that you have to put in bulky groups, and so that this rotation cannot occur. I mean, this system is quite flexible, so it is not that there have been other attempts also being done. There are various ways to escape this kind of the attempt to fix it. And you saw it from our results, but there are possibilities. And the advantage would be that this is then a molecular property. Then the molecule itself would be fluorescent. And it is not necessary then to put it into a solid state, which might be more difficult to handle or so. So therefore, this is the idea to use these substitutions.
Okay.
To achieve this effect.
Okay. And these systems are, I mean, the interest is in solid state.
For this tetraphenyl ethylene, it is actually the molecular system. So this should, it should also fluorescence in solution, for example.
Uh-huh.
This would be the idea. This is what I mean by molecular property.
Okay.
Whereas this TPE itself in solution will not fluorescence. It will decay to the ground state ultra fast. Whereas when you have it in solid state, it does, but then it is more manipulation. But we thought to start from this knowledge and really to make these substitutions to really to force the molecule itself.
Okay.
By simple substitution, not by big other chemical transformations.
Okay. Other question? Frank?
Yeah, Han. Why? Okay. I mean, as an experimental chemist, I would not have thought of putting lots of cyano groups onto the tetraphenylethylene. I would just put methyl groups, because then you can tell the difference between steric and electronic effect.
Yeah, this has been done. In fact, this has been done before. So I did not tell the whole story. This has a partial effect. Yeah, it depends where you put your methyl groups. One also has tried somehow to connect the rings and so. There's some other attempts have been made. They are only partially effective. Yeah, depending where you put them, the methyl groups. There was one combination which also would do the job. Yeah, I don't know whether one even would put could put larger aliphatic groups larger than methyl, but they are also quite flexible. Yeah, whereas the CN groups are quite, they are linear, they cannot do much. That was, and I don't know now the feasibility really of the that one really could produce this of the synthesis, but it, maybe it's not impossible, might not be impossible, but it's more like a model study, but one could think certainly more about it. This is certainly not the end, end of this kind of path.
The fact that the simple DFT approaches give you the wrong order of the states for pyrene is a real problem.
Yeah,
as I see it, that means that a lot of things, the conclusions that come out of that for excited states may be badly wrong.
Is there
any way to fix that?
Not in a simple way. I think more or less all the DFT functions show this problem. I think I remember one paper by Grimme. He discusses this where you can play around with a percentage of Hartree-Fock, you know, but somehow this, whatever you are doing, it has also some counterproductive effect. And so I'm not an expert, I'm just a simple-minded user of DFT. So, at the moment, to my knowledge, there's no solution for this. What I could imagine is that one, because we want to use it in dynamics, that one uses machine learning to make a pragmatic correction to these energy surfaces. This is something what one could add a simple constant energy. Yeah, which certainly would not be such a good idea, but one could shift the potential curves. But one would have to do it in a sophisticated way. And this machine learning or this artificial intelligence might be a possibility. Yeah, this is something I wanted to talk to Mario, or if I don't know if Max has some ideas about it. So, but directly to develop the method as it is, there's no good progress. But the greater difficulty even is this, that one doesn't get this double excited state. There's no real method. There is this spin flip. This might be this is a possibility. This is what is applied, but that one cannot get this double excited state, because for the singlet fission, or not only for singlet fission, this double excited states appear always in the spectra. We have done a lot of investigations, and it appears always, and that they are missing. This is also a problem.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay. Well, I have. It's not a question. It's just a curiosity. I would like to listen your opinion. You have witnessed the evolution of computers, the evolution of theoretical methods, and many other things that you have been witnessed since the beginning up till now. In your opinion, what is most important to do now what is left to do now? What would you like to see? The next step.
Now, there's not one step. I would split it up in the question of the simulation. By simulation, I mean not just to geometry optimization, but really to dynamic simulation. And the other thing is, of course, to improve the methods, because the simulations still depend, of course, depend on the used energy surface, and this is still in photodynamics. This is still the major problem. So the advances in the dynamics techniques, not only surface hopping or this multi-layer MCTTH and this multiple spawning. This is all marvelous, but it all. And this has to be developed further, of course. But of course, one needs still better methods. However, what I'm seeing, I mean, the methods do get better, but they get much more complicated. If you look at DFT, of course, you can choose always something, but the knowledge what really to use is so complicated as it looks to me. And I'm, as I said, I'm a simple user of DFT. Whether there are systematic attempts for systematic improvements in classification and so on, but I do not see the necessary improvements. I see only that it gets either more parameters, or you know, I am not sure. I don't think we're certainly not at the dead end, because there's never such a case. There's always some progress. But if you ask me how to do this, we are doing. I'm on the conservative side. We are doing this ab initio multi-reference way, and I think we will be able to show that this still is a kind of will survive, and we will be able to do it much faster. Then it is a clean method, but at the moment I would not sell this in that sense, that one really can do fast simulations and so on. There you have to go to this. It is all this DFT. You can improve maybe the excited states, but the intersection with the ground state is a problem also. It's a severe problem. Yeah, we just stop the calculation at a certain point. Yeah, because then you get negative excitation energies and so on. This and has been shown by Todd Martinez. Has explained this, that these things are why they are not doing well. So that in the methods, if you ask me for a clear vision, I don't have it. I don't see it. But it is maybe an absence of my knowledge.
Okay. So I thank you again, Hans, very much, very much. It was very nice to listen to you, to see your work, to meet a lot of friends. And I do hope to meet you again in the next webinar or sooner. It was very nice, and it's impressive the quality of your work. Thank you very much for everything you have done for computational quantum chemistry. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Congratulations.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Francisco, would you like to see something? Okay. So.
Bye bye.
See you in December.
Okay. Okay. Bye-bye to Brazil.
Bye-bye. Ciao, Adelia.
Ciao, Borin. Obrigada. Ciao.
Yeah.
Bye-bye.